through the records carefully?
My record, yeah. I heard something about fixing it. You?
I haven't heard for a while. I want to put out a single.
Which one?
I don't know.
Me too. I know there should be a single now.
I'm going to put out a single. I'm going to put it out. I'm telling
Devil
you.
Devil Woman should be a single.
You know what? Is it running now?
Yes.
Okay, just let it run.
Yeah.
And as long as I see the meter moving, it means it's recording, right?
Yeah.
Correct.
So it's all right. No, as a matter of fact, close the door. Thank you. I think that this is going to knock you off now.
Oh, yeah, you got the cover. Oh, yeah, you might.
It's just a proof now. This.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Devil Woman?
Yeah, man.
Eat that chicken?
Yeah.
Russians over there? Hope Calling Blues?
Yeah.
Wham, bam, thank you, man.
Hey, oh, Lord, it's about that song.
It's like a little tambourine.
Yeah.
And this is the mushroom.
Yeah, that's pretty bad, man.
Isn't that something? I think it's fantastic.
Yeah, who did that, man?
My boy and I, you know, my man.
Who, the same photographer?
Laurie. No, no.
Oh.
This is a designer.
Yeah.
Hmm?
This is crazy, man.
Mingus is never, I don't want to say Charlie Mingus,
yeah.
Mingus.
Okay.
Mingus, oh yeah.
Yeah, it's crazy, man.
Huh?
Yeah.
Best cover.
That's a weird cover, man.
I have it on two papers, see? So this is like,
even the cover is commercial, man.
Sure. Oh, we're going to go all out on this record. Yeah. I haven't made up my mind. So this is matte paper, this is glossy paper.
Oh, yeah. See
how the colors are different?
This gets more classy, more something.
It is classier.
I don't know what it, right away I thought, you know, the shine shouldn't be on it. Could they do it without a shine? A flat color?
If you do it on this paper, then it's going to be like this. You can't shine it, you can't put varnish on it. It's just, as you see, that's it. You do it on this paper, on this you put
varnish over the top.
Varnish over this. Lamination.
Where did this cat get this hog from, man? That's not a hog. That's not a pig. That's a hog.
Yeah. See? Ecclesiastics.
Mm-hmm.
Wild, isn't it?
Yeah.
You think you like this paper more than this paper?
I think I do.
I don't know. It's the only thing I'm afraid of. See, if you do it on this paper.
You get dirty.
This is all so white that in stores and so on, people
you get
have
dirty.
It.
I know. This
Whereas
is safe.
This, you put
yeah.
a
Let me check it now. Let me check it now. They have no flat coats to put all that on.
You can't put anything on that. On this paper, you can't do anything.
Oh, yeah. This is going to shine more. I can see this.
This is going to shine much more.
No, it either got to be extremely shine like that, extremely like
that's
you.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that now.
See?
Yeah.
It's a little stronger.
Yeah.
You see, now, look at this red and this red. Mm-hmm. See, there's a difference.
Yeah.
Now, they're both lovely.
Yeah, you know, let me tell you something about
you
this
see,
here.
This is darker, for instance, than this.
Mm-hmm.
Even on the black, you see?
Yeah.
Or the blue.
Yeah. Let me tell you, this is part for your notes. There's a very contradictory thing in here. On here, I'm saying, like a pimp says, get that devil woman and get me some dough, give me some money. Well, see, right in my book, which I want to explain to you, all my whole life is up to one level, you know, there is no past, no future, it's all one thing now, you know what I mean? Because if you notice, I turn right around and on this piece I say, Ecclesiastes, I say, I've been wrong, remember that? Well, see, you can say that's a contradictory, but it's not. Because when this did happen, was in a very early period of my life. I'm not trying to tell you it's wrong anyway, but still at one point I was thinking maybe it'd be safe to be a pimp.
Yes.
Or something like that. To be a jazz musician.
Yes.
So, in fact, I want to say the whole thing. In the book, it's written just like this. This girl who I convinced that she should do this was about to go on a very expensive date in Acapulco.
Yes.
Over $3,500 guaranteed for 3 days, you know. Like, she meet this cat. He's a strange cat, one in the quarter and all that. And I had this visitation that if I let her go that night, I would really become a pimp. I mean, a cold person.
Yes.
And I'll lose all the talent I ever had. Yes. And it took me hours to keep her from going because this time she'd always said, I'm not revealing her anyway because it's way out of this period of my life.
I understand.
She said, I can never become a whore because they don't think, they don't. So I sit around, I watch them, how they read funny books. She said, I would never be like that. And so a few months go by, and she says she's just doing it to, as an experimental, intellectual
exercise.
Yeah, to see what would happen. Yeah. And so she got caught, and I didn't realize it until this day when I said, don't go. I said, the phone rang, you got to sit here and let it ring. I couldn't hardly get her to come back up the stairs. She's on the way. She's like, but I got to make this money. We'll be out of this trouble. I said, no, we got to get out of this trouble without that money. I just want to tell you that one. Air condition?
I think so.
Yeah. See, in the book, well, the book is my life, Nez. I'm not trying to write a, I'm trying to, actually, I may not even put the book out.
Yeah.
Let me just, you know, to analyze myself. All my, you know, I don't know if this is important to you for notes at all, anyway.
I'd like to know, because I'd like to mention the book in the notes.
This is,
or have something about the book.
And this here, and this piece here is about the book. It's, and all my life, in the struggle and being the color they call me, Miles Maxwell can call me, it's spelled S-C-H-I-T-T, but it's pronounced shit. Shit-colored nigga. Well, in school, this color black man would never accept me. See, it's, you've heard of racial discrimination in your own race?
Of course.
Well,
of course.
I wasn't black enough, and neither was I light enough, like Clayton Powell, you know him?
Yes.
To be accepted as the,
yes,
the high yellow.
Yes.
So I ended up in school hanging out with the Mexican cats and Japanese, and a few cats that were just,
yes,
scattered around.
Kind of in between.
Yeah, and actually, the only the closest friends I found were Japanese, the Nobuoka family.
This is in Los Angeles.
Los Angeles, man. And this is going through an analysis. This is what the whole book is an analysis of my life. And I wanted to say Passion of a Black Man, and then it came to me that they
you
say
were,
I'm not. Miles Davis walked up and said, make fun of me right now. I says, man, you trying to pass for colored? You know?
Yes, yes.
You did?
I know what you mean.
In fact, I find myself, and I asked myself, like, was I trying to sound real colored on here? Remember I said,
yes, yes,
you know, and I was saying, am I really that far off? But I don't think so, because I was in this environment, and I don't think the skin had nothing to do with it. I would like to think that, in this funny society.
I think that, look, especially if knowing your background and what you just said, you're obviously not in one and not in the other. So you're in a very peculiar
situation. I would like
situation.
To, always, I'm trying to, in the book,
I'm
trying to find a no-color one.
Yeah, where, yeah.
I've always, you know, this sounds funny, man. Most of my marriages you've seen all have been white.
I know.
Well, I never met any colored girls in jazz clubs until maybe recently now they start to come out.
Yes. So you never really had occasion to meet any.
No, it was, and I've been, a few people that have enough nerve, like I say, Max, will say, you know, how come you always marry a white girl, and how come they always look like Celia? They even say that, you know, the same one every time. And it is funny, like psychologically, I had a school teacher that reminded me of Celia, you know, and the one I got, the wife I got now. Don't mention this, man.
No, I won't.
Yeah, you know what to do.
You're gonna see the notes before they come out, anyhow.
Yeah.
So don't worry. You can say anything you want.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
I'm gonna show you the notes, and you see them, and we'll take out anything you want.
Yeah.
Now I want to ask you a few questions.
I know. I hope so.
Yeah. Now, isn't this the first album where you play, where you don't play one note on the bass that you never made?
Yes, it is.
First, so it's kind of a beginning, right?
Yeah, it
I
is.
Mean, in a way. So first, now, why did you decide to make an entire album playing only piano?
I've always wanted to play piano, man. That's, see, it's, at home, I was going to be a piano player. At least in my heart, they said, what do you want to play? But my sister already played piano, and they had to spend the money for her, and they wouldn't spend it for me, so I had to choose another instrument. And somehow, someone had told my father, I'd heard him discussing that a colored kid should play a cello, so he could switch over to bass. And I said, well, I'm going to play cello because I heard a man tell my father that. And the piano, man, I just think I would have been a good piano player. I'm sure, you know, I haven't got time now. I know that, you know, the technical facility I have on bass, I haven't even touched it. I can go do anything,
yes,
you know?
Yes, of course.
And so I know when I can tell how hard I'm struggling. I've tried to get the left hand up. I'm not going to really make it to do on the piano what I want, so I'm going back to bass. You know, understand me.
But you will, in the future, you plan to play bass?
And piano,
but
yes.
But continue on piano,
yes,
too?
Yeah, but I made a mistake of putting down the bass. Yes. Well, there's no mistake, because I just grabbed the other day, and I was telling, in the book, there's a piece called Vals Minuet that Jimmy Black used to play, written by Serge Koussevitzky.
Yes.
And so, Slam Stewart.
Was a cello player, too.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
He was a great cello player.
Mm, I would like to hear him on cello. I know he played the solo bass.
And bass beautiful. Too. Yeah,
yeah, he played this beautiful. Oh man, unbelievable. That's what the piece. Some of the things he did: Valse Minuet and Shots on Threes. So Slam Stewart was at a jam session, and Junior Batten came by, and Red Connell, he was playing Red Connell's bass, and Slam kind of felt, I don't know what he felt, but he said, "Can you bow?" In an intermission in the back room, and he said, "Oh, you can't bow. None of your kids can bow. Run on the bass, but you can't bow." And Jimmy's, oh man, sweet person.
I know.
So I was nasty, and I felt, who's this cat picking on him? You know, because I said, man, he can cut you on, you know, bowing. And he said, oh, I don't cut him. He says, but I can bowl, you know, a little bit. Very kind. He said, don't talk to that, Charlie. He always tried to tell me I didn't have the right approach. And so he wouldn't bowl, so I took Red's bass, and I started playing the thing, and it was real bad. It's called Volume 1. It's a very hard, tough piece. And he took it and played. Then we played a duet on it, and we was playing jazz against it, improvising Contrary Motion. Jimmy Blanton.
You and Blanton.
Yeah. I was just a kid then, man. Yes. But I had that kind of training first.
Yes.
And so I was telling my wife, I said, hey, man, it's a hard piece. I couldn't play it. I said, I bet I can't play it. And I grabbed the bass, and it came out better than ever, man. And I didn't even touch the bass, just like when I was a kid, rather than now, because I don't even bow no more. I was kind of amazed that how the knowledge that the instrument is. I don't even think of notes. It's like, dung, the sound, you know? Yes. I don't say B flat. I got to look at the notes on the piano and all that. Yes. And bass is just there, man.
It's just there.
Yeah. Now, I'm not saying this, that might sound like I'm saying that it's a bad record. I'm trying to say that, no. How can I say that, man?
I know what you mean. I know what you mean.
Well, on this
you've
record.
Always been all the, I mean, you've had a career now for about, say, professionally for about 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Yes.
I mean, you started in the early 40s.
Oh, easy, yeah.
Or late 30s, early
40s. That's right, 41, so 39
about,
with Louis Armstrong.
20 years, right?
Yeah.
What was your first job?
Louis Armstrong.
Oh, yeah?
Not my first job.
I mean,
that's
your
first
job
big time.
With a name band.
Yeah, I was with Lee Young. Well, that's kind of big in a way.
Yeah.
Lee Young is Lester's brother. And we was working at Club Alabama, and Louis Armstrong came in and liked me for some reason and asked me to join the band. I never knew what he meant. The guy said he was making a Southern tour. So I got in the band and made a few one nights and got to the South, and the guy started telling me about the South, how it was.
You've never been South before?
No, man, but the older fellas, they said, now you gotta be careful when you get down there. And I just, it began to tear me out inside because I knew I would get killed.
Yes.
They told me some of the things they'd been through, and they said, if you can't condition yourself to this, man, you ought to ask Louis to let you go back home.
Yes.
And so I asked Louis to on a boat, man. He made him turn the ferry back around and take me back to the pier.
Oh, yes?
I don't know how he did it. Money, I guess, could get you to do anything.
And you left him?
Yeah, and he got somebody down South.
But you went with him for a while?
Yes. Oh, yeah, I played
how
quite a while.
How long did you stay with Louis?
Oh, let me see. About 2 months.
About 2 months.
Making a tour around the United States, all around the East Coast, East Coast, West Coast, then he going South. And I remember we got to Chicago and places like that.
And then you left and drunk.
Yeah, and man, you know, we're very good friends, even today. We see him on the street, hey, Mingus, you know? Because, you know, he understood being,
sure.
You know, I didn't know
sure.
what I was doing out there.
Sure, because he came from there, so
yeah.
He had that.
Yeah.
Since he was a child.
Well, you gotta live.
Sure.
And I, you know, I probably would have made it, Nez. I probably would have made it. I hate to think about it. Because I remember I did what kind of go south with Lionel Hampton and saw some things you wouldn't believe.
You did go south with Hampton?
Yeah.
How long were you with Hampton?
Oh, 2 years.
2 years?
Yeah, 2 years. That was smooth. That was a testing now, man. I dig Lionel, man. If you put that in print, it would gas me, because so many people say he's a drag. Is that man, does not, everything he say he's going to do, he does it. You may not like his wife, but even she's above board.
Yes.
I work with a band of guys, say they promise this. If they promise the money, you get that. But most guys, when they start the band, they go on cheaper. They think that they should, and they get there, and five other guys get more, and they get jealous.
You're still friends with Hampton?
Oh, yeah, man. Even Gladys, man.
Yeah.
They used to be, see, people are very nice people. They used, every kind of holiday, like Valentine's Day, a card, they give you cards.
Yes.
Christmas, they give you a bonus.
Yes.
And the guys didn't get no more respect. So they began to cut down on things with only the certain guys and privacy.
Yes.
And I can, you know, I saw them try and buy friends, which I know you can't do.
Yeah, that's right.
Because that's really where it was. She would, a guy say, I know a guitar player, kind of popular now. He came to band for $9 a week on the road. That's impossible in those days. Nobody was getting less than 35 then. That's, you know, that's cheap nowadays.
That's right.
For a cat to go out And so he heard the guys getting 135 and somebody getting more. Buckner was getting way more. Buckner getting yeah. lots more. And he got very angry and started telling the guys how dirty they're treating him. So Gladys said, fellas, this man came to band. He said he want to join. And we had a guitar player that was leaving. We had two guitar players for a while. She told how it went down. So now he's telling you that I'm cheating him. Says he gave me a salary, said, to pay him the same amount of money he's making on his job. And that's what I paid him. Uh-huh. So see, I wasn't trying to get him cheap. So that's what he asked for, you know?
Yeah. Sure, look, everybody doesn't get
yeah.
that. Now, but were you fooling around with the piano all this time?
Oh, yeah, always, man.
Always? Always have?
Yeah. That's so, before,
but most people don't know that.
Oh,
most people who know you, you know, don't know
well, that. Everything I compose is on piano. Like, anything you ever heard me, like, for instance, Lovebird, those things have all been played first by me on piano, or else I wouldn't give it to any musician to play. Yeah. I think if it can't be played by the composer, then he shouldn't ask anyone else to play it.
That's right.
It may sound funny, but now I may not be able to play it like Bud Powell,
yes.
but I can say, I'm going to flip it on you, man.
How you
did it?
Years, you know?
I mean,
I can play the things, and the finger may not be right, but That's what I compose, man.
You always compose everything on the piano first.
Spontaneous, and the latest thing I've done since tape is to make on tape first and change them around, you know?
Now, I noticed one thing. You know, we've been recording together for many years now. There is never any written music at your, any of your record sessions, right? I don't think I've hardly ever... Have I ever... I don't think
no,
ever
by the time
had.
We get there, we put
so
it away.
How do you teach the members of your band your pieces, which aren't simple pieces
yeah.
by any means?
Well, I'm very... You got the band, this band here. Actually, Jimmy Nip and Booker have been with me years ago.
Yes.
Well, some of the guys didn't stay long, like John Handy, for instance. But they would learn how to... memorize. I taught them scales that go against every chord, and they begin to find that the hearing is simple, much simpler than they thought. For instance, I think it's hypnosis, man. I do it with Danny very, very much. I say, man, like you got that. Like you, I know you can do it. You use that thing a whole lot. I say, I know you can do this, man, because like you think it's hard. As soon as you, I say, if you learn this one note here,
yeah.
that's the only one that's hanging you up. He may have 80 notes,
yes.
but I show his the hard interval, and once you learn that, then you're straight. And Booker, man, I can take, if I say whatever the piece is, one time, he's got it.
But actually, your method of composition is rather different from other people because it seems to me that although your pieces are very carefully composed,
mm-hmm.
you still leave them a lot of freedom, even in the playing of the, I'm not talking about the ad lib solos,
in the composition.
The parts of the composition,
yeah.
there's a lot of freedom. More than in many groups, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, there is. Yeah, you had a good question. See, not a question. You have to even listen. What I do is, I know it's kind of saying. I guess I'm not selfish. I know if I got a thing, like if I say to Booker like this, well, I know that he can do this as long
yes.
as he starts where I start and end where I end. He may say ba ba lu ba. He make many different
yes.
movements.
And they do.
Yeah, and I think this
and
is
when
better.
When we do two takes on one tune,
yeah.
actually, even the composed parts can be quite
different
from
Eastern.
One take to the
yeah.
other, which shows that even within the composition,
they exchange it. He has
the
right to. That this I think is good though, healthy. I got this idea.
I think it's great, but I think you're the only man who's
yeah,
doing it.
It could be. Could be,
you
I don't
know.
I think General Martin did it though.
General Martin did that too.
I think, see now I'm telling you, man, I didn't know this. Martin Williams drugged me. Because there's a thing going out now where guys take one card and they play on it.
Mm-hmm.
That's something else General Martin did. Well, see, I was very interested in this when I first thought I discovered it. And Martin says, well, General Martin did that. And here's some music he showed me he did it. And I dropped the whole thing. And now this trend, Miles Davis is making all kinds of money on it.
Yes.
You know what
yes.
I'm talking about? The
yes.
kind of type of thing. I did it with one tune on it with you. That Love Chant.
Love Chant, yes. But I noticed something else.
I mean, I'm not, it's not like I'm saying I should make money. I don't mean that.
No,
everybody
no.
should make money, but I don't think... You know, Helen Merrill, she
yes.
said it in good words to me. She says, "Make it, I don't think I'm supposed to appeal to the masses.
Yes.
Or millions of people. Like, I think that what I have is for special people. I like that. You know, I don't, maybe a little more than she got. I don't know. You know
yes.
but, I don't know if it's supposed to appeal to millions. And if it does, that ain't wrong either. Jesus Christ appeals to millions, don't he?
That's right.
He's a pretty bad guy. Both ways.
But I noticed something else. somehow there is a strong unity to your groups, mm-hmm. and it doesn't seem to matter too much who is playing with you. When people play with you, they play differently than they play when they're on their own.
I tell you what, I've noticed, to answer that question, I go back to Lionel Hampton again. I've seen Lionel Hampton, which I'm sure mass hypnosis, by him throwing himself completely in and accepting the full spirit of the composition, he's made people jump out of the bleachers and break their legs.
Yes.
Now, you know this is fact.
I have so.
Now, anybody work with him, they learn two things. You learn, you learn what that is, yeah. and you learn, like Jacket and all the guys,
yes.
that they go complete overboard with this thing, that showman thing, I guess they call it showman. Lionel don't call it showman. He is putting his complete heart in it.
That's right.
There's a difference in saying than watching yourself affect people,
That's
than throwing
right.
yourself in. Well, I try to see the Hamp's reason, and when I go out to the mouth to leave my soul, I have to wait a month sometime to get to blaming his fingers. When I get out there, I say, all right, Hamp, here it is. And I put my whole heart in it, and I find out that the whole people, everybody feels it. And so playing with the band, and only certain people it affects. I haven't got this one guy, I call his name again, John Handy. I can never get to John. It's because he's isolated in another world that's just as strong.
Yes.
Because John is always conscious that he wants to be a leader. I mean, yes. I mean usually you would call John Doe,
yes.
if you want to use this
yes.
example.
Yes.
But people like Booker and people who are happy and content and can throw themselves into playing.
Yeah, well, I have to go with my many examples.
Yeah.
For instance, mm-hmm. and some of them, they're great musicians when they play with you, and they're great musicians when they play on their own.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not
two different
the
things.
Same.
You know, it shouldn't be. This is what it shouldn't
when,
be,
when
man.
When they play with you,
and when I play with them, I should play different.
Yeah.
This is what I learned, man. I played half. I didn't play my music. I played half music. You helped me say what I want to say. That's what. This is what is probably wrong. Why I can't play with anybody? Because, I mean, as a side man, I would like to. You know, I used to try and say, well, I don't be a band leader. Be like George DeVivier. Just make me a few dates. And make me some record dates and make it. But I find that by the time other guys lose their identity, the record date is over with, and it's too late to save the music, because they're trying to hold on to what they believe rather than say, what does this composer mean, and give themselves up for the whoever
yes.
the leader is.
But they somehow seem to fall. I've seen musicians mm. who've been with you for a very short time,
yeah,
and they're playing your music and not their music when they play with
yeah.
you somehow. I mean, it's part of them too.
Yeah. You're right,
but
man.
It fits into your music.
I got two cats I couldn't change too well. Remember Charlie and Lonnie?
Yes.
The bebop kids from Detroit?
Yes.
I finally got them even. I started making them, putting scale, two different keys on them to make them get out of that bebop line.
Yes.
Because, see, I wasn't combating them. I was trying to fight Charlie Parker, and he's dead.
Yes.
If you got a guy that's completely brainwashed by somebody like that, you can't change them, what they're doing, because Bird's not here to show him what he would do with my music.
That's right.
You know, in fact, Bird would have played my music different.
That's right.
I know he would have, man.
That's right.
That'd been something else.
For instance, Jackie McLean with you
mm-hmm.
was playing your music.
Another thing. Now he's back to what he was doing before.
Yeah, but yeah. when it was with you, he's
yeah.
great now. He was great, but he was playing a different kind of music.
And something else, man. You notice when I was back, Willie Jones and those drummers like that. If you notice, always trying to have Jimmy Nippon and Danny there. Without them, it wouldn't happen. I'm
yeah.
pretty sure. pretty sure of that. Jimmy for the lines and the way I phrase things,
yes.
and he also knows he'll show a cat wrong, almost, you know, like I said, and he'll play it the way I used to play it, and you hear these two melodies going, because
yes.
he knows that I don't want it the exact same way every time.
Yes.
See this.
So he'll change
yeah,
it on his
yeah,
own.
Yeah. Yeah. He would give Booker a little different line, and Booker said, "Well, you got a B flat." He said, well, "I know. I'm, you know."
Yes.
Yeah. But Danny, I'm getting a little older. Although I don't think it's really anymore. I felt like I was getting tired. That's another reason I kind of laid off bass. I used to have, Monk's got the most perfect time in the world. I used to have that kind of time, man. I know it. When it, never get lost, you know. But taking so many drummers like I did before I got Danny,
yes.
and even teaching him was hard, man.
Yes.
Although he was very talented. If you remember, I think you caught him right away.
In the very beginning.
Yeah.
That's right. And technically, he wasn't very strong in those days.
No.
He's just begun to play drums.
Yeah.
You know,
and yet,
he was doing it. I
yeah.
mean, even then you could tell.
It was in his head, man. I showed him a way that all musicians should learn. He was trying to do things. That you like Max? That's good. I said, now, Max makes, you know, okay, now you can make this like that. I said, suppose your stick slips. Well, you're supposed to listen to that and make some out of that, too. So this cat began to learn. I said, the whole idea is to keep the time in your mind And if you make a mistake, remember that mistake, and next time make it part of the music. You know, and, yes. and keep that time going, you know?
Yes, yes.
And I hear that in his playing now. He's got Max, and he's got the mistakes. He's got everything else that goes on now.
But he's making improvements. It's incredible how he's improved.
Yeah, man.
He's been with you about 5 years.
Yeah, right? At least. Seriously. Yeah.
Six.
Going six. I was checking on Celia, because Celia and my wife, you know, it's 9 years ago we got married. And yeah, he came 3 years, she's been gone 3 years, and he was 6 years. I saw a cat say the rhythm section, one of the reviews on what record was, the all-time rhythm section. I think if he listened, or just didn't write that and didn't listen, but there's something to that. It's three things going on always, and it's two men playing.
Which rhythm section?
Me and Danny playing, it's you like playing with three men.
Yes, yes.
Because we have that, this going, it's obvious. We have another one going, cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha- sometimes you don't miss the piano if there is none.
Yes.
Although I'm missing for the sound.
Yes.
I didn't expect this kind of view. I didn't know this is more natural than I thought.
This is the first time you're singing, right? This is the album of firsts.
Well, see, not really, because I've always been saying things that would, if a mic had been close, like you did this time.
Yes.
In fact, you did it once before, I believe, when I hollered.
Yeah.
On
that's right.
The Blues and Roots.
That's
but
right.
I just was afraid. I always want to say things, and people say I'm hollering. But man, I feel that. I'm not affecting that. And on a job, I do it. I'll be singing a song, and that's how Fables of Fathers was born. By just, I say, name me someone who's ridiculous one night, Danny. And he said, he named one guy. He only could think of one guy. Then pretty soon, he named about 10 or 20, you know? But, and I don't know. I don't think about it as showmanship. I think it's trying to be creative on the spot and think of words. Like, I didn't plan those words. And after I heard what I did, I wish I'd have thought a little longer on that and sung some more, you know?
Yes.
Yeah. Because I kind of like my voice, man.
I like it too.
And when I heard possibilities in it being a you know, a good voice, man. I really, you know, after, I didn't really know until I heard this Devil Woman.
But do you listen much to blues singers and so on?
You know, I was, oh man, you know, Joe
just
Turner?
I'm asking you this for the tape now.
Oh,
you know,
with Joe Turner. In fact, I was very sick in bed. They thought I was going to die of scarlet fever one time. And you know, the last thing I had, it went from that, and it went to arthritis and all my bones. Mm-hmm. And I met this chick, the girl who married my mother of my sons, named Jean. And I had no work, and I went down and started, you know, T-Bone Walker?
Yes.
I pretty raised with him, man.
Yeah,
raised with T-Bone, man.
That's
T-Bone got me a job, he liked my family. And I didn't get playing with him at this point. He said, I can get you the after-hour job playing with some club. Not the Flamingo, no one down the street, Jack's Basket Room or something.
On Central?
With Joe Tone, on Central Avenue, it's right across from the pool hall.
Yeah.
You remember the Club Alabama?
Yeah.
They had one backstage, back by pool hall.
I know.
Club Alabama across the street.
And they had some food in there too.
Yeah, Art Taylor used to come and play in that cold.
Yes, I've been in that place.
I know, the food was good.
Yes.
It's in the back of the pool hall.
They had really
Yeah. Well, I got this job with Joe Turner, and which I didn't realize what I was really getting into. You know, I didn't realize that now the value of the people I played with, Kid Ory, and to know that when I get scared of and tired of hearing the same riffs playing for the young so-called modern kids around that are playing Bird, I can lean back and say, well, this is the way Joe felt, man, being in that environment. Because he's always telling me, man, this is, don't ever let that go.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Yeah. And then I know you got Joe, and I'm hurt your feelings, but T-Bone Walker, man, I think he hasn't been used right.
I know.
Where is he? Is he with your label?
Yeah, but we haven't played.
Is he with your label?
Yeah, we haven't. We, you know, I've made records with him and so on, but not what we, you know.
Well, I don't. Maybe
he's
it's too
out
long.
There, we don't see him. You know,
oh, that's what it is, man. On the coast.
And then you go and you do a
session. Man, this dude used to do, man. He just sit and make up songs like the folk singers do with his guitar. With Charle Mingus, I'm gonna sing the blues.
Yes.
Words you never heard before. And he just make up a whole story and you flip, man.
Time on guitar is fantastic, isn't it?
Is this something, man?
Huh?
Yeah, he's something, man.
He's another one that can hypnotize.
Yeah.
Just he plays those low notes on the guitar.
Right? He invented the thing that most everybody use now on all the instruments, on the strings, and boom, dang, dong, dang, all about your dang, dang.
Oh, that's T-Bone Walker.
Yeah, well, a lot of horns during that, man.
Yeah. Yeah. So you grew up with all those people, huh?
Yeah, T-Boy and there's a cat named, now, you heard, trying to play like Fats Waller? There's a piano player named Bottoms. You ever heard of Bottoms?
No, I did not.
Bottoms, just like his name, great big cat, man, and played like Fats, but he didn't sing. But he didn't miss nothing. Remember Garland Finney?
Yes, I remember this, him.
Well, Garland Finney had a left hand like Fats.
Mm-hmm.
And he played stride piano. Well, I worked all those people. Like, and then I said Kid Ory. I guess you know about that.
Did you play with Ory?
Yeah. This, that was...
In the 40s.
Well, you can help me. It's in the 40s, and you can probably get the exact date. It's when Barney Bigard left Duke Ellington.
No, I heard that band. What you
Yeah,
heard?
I was in that band. And Billy Berg's
club. Billy Berg's.
Yeah.
I was there every night.
Exactly. That was a bad band, man.
I was there. That was Kid Ory's first job because he'd been retired for 10 years.
Yeah.
He came back and he was in Barney's band, but it wasn't called Billy Berg's because it was...
His new fancier place.
Yeah.
It's facing the ice skating rings.
Yeah, it was out
remember?
West a little.
I'm trying to remember the name of the place because it's in my book.
I know that. Something room. Zebra room.
Zebra, or? I think. Something like...
Some room.
Not zebra. Like you're right. It's a room. It's a... A French word, I think, like with an E or something. Encore? No. It's something.
I've heard. I'll find the word for
yeah.
it. I mean the name. Because
yeah.
I used to be there every night because Ory was my friend then.
Well, see, you know something, man? He was.
That was in 1943.
He had blisters on his lips when he opened up because he went car fishing together. He tried to say, he said, man, I'm not. He says, I'm playing the same thing I played. I'm going to try and change it. What's this music they call now? Bebop? Well, we're going to play whatever I play.
Who said that?
Kid Ory. He said, so let's go craw fishing.
That's it.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a funny kid.
That was in 43.
Yeah, it's right in there, yeah.
That was in 1943. I was there.
You get me straight, man, because I they tried to draft me in 19, when the class of 41. That's around 41 I got drafted. And some of them didn't want me, so they kicked me out of the Army. And I came back and got that gig. Yeah, I was a good man.
That was a baby.
Yeah.
And there was a red-headed trumpet player, wasn't it?
Red Mac.
Trumpet, right?
Bam, bam.
Remember, sure.
Then you were out there when they had Lester Young and Lee Young band?
Yeah, I was there.
With Bumps Myers and remember the trumpet player Camel?
Of course.
Red Mac was in that band
of
after
course.
Him. Yeah.
I used to hear that band. They were playing in the same club, too. They played that club, I think.
That was Swain. That was, he had the Capri. Remember the
Capri?
And he had a Swain club.
Yes. You played the Capri, man.
I played all of them.
No, with Ory and Barney Bigard.
That's
what
it was,
Capri.
It was, huh?
That's the Capri. That's where it was, the Capri.
Yeah.
That's where you played with Barney and Ory.
Because he had a Swain club.
I have a picture of that band someplace.
You remember he had one on Sunset Boulevard?
I'm going to find the photograph of the band.
He had 3 or 4 clubs going at one time, finally.
Yes, he had one on Vine.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
He had the Capri.
The Swain club was on Vine? And then it moved to Sunset. I'll tell you something, man. You know, this is probably don't interest you, but it's in the book. That's why this area is kind of clear to me. I was there with some guy trying to kill Billy Berg. In fact, I might have saved him. I was in the parking lot, and the car comes driving at him. He's running all kinds of ways. They chased him, man.
Oh, yeah?
They ran him out of business. His last club. I saw him go down, man. Mm-hmm. Next time I saw him, he was on Main Street.
You know, he's still out there trying to. He still opens the club and closes. And he's still doing that.
They're sure against him, man.
Now.
Yeah, they put thumbs
down. Everybody was against him.
Yeah, and he made it so big.
And I think that he was a good guy. You know?
He was, man. You know,
he helped a lot of musicians.
Yeah,
I like Billy Berg.
Hey, were you at the session? You was probably at the session, the all-night session with Ben Webster, Coleman Hawkins, Lester Young, Jimmy Blanton, Slam Stewart. They at his Billy Berg's after our club. The police let him stay up all night till 11 the next day.
No, I missed that.
It was a special session. Oh, man, that was something.
That one.
That was something. I didn't even play that night except in the back room, but Blanton, man. A lot of people don't know what they say about bass. Now that's something I like to clear up to speak about bass. There's a reason why this guy wrote a review says Mingus inspired and Blanton inspired basses. Well, a lot of people don't know my age. See, I was playing how I'm playing in 1939 the same way.
Yes.
And the evidence is I was studying the Red Collar as a kid because I couldn't read. Whereas I've been in the cello and the guy that taught me was Joe Comfort with Nat Cole.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, well, just turn the radio Mingus and start to play it. So I turned the radio and got all off because I was using cello fingering.
Right.
So by the time I went to Red, who himself was a great soloist in these days.
Yes.
But I guess as you go older, you get tired of trying. And a lot of people don't know this. So I was taking a lesson and Joe Comfort left Nat Cole and a guy named Johnny Miller went in. No, it's probably reversed. I think Miller went in first.
Right.
And so Miller was over at Red's house and Nat had told him to learn Jack the Bear. Now, this is true, man. So I'm going to take a lesson, and I hadn't even heard Jack DeBerry yet.
Who's going to give you a lesson? Joe Conference?
No, no, I studied with Red Counter.
Oh, Red Counter.
Joe started me off wrong. Joe's all ears.
I see.
See, Joe's home taught, you know.
Yes.
Play an instrument. He pick up trumpet and play it in 5 minutes if you fool him. Mm. You make a new instrument, he'll play it.
He'll play.
I remember a guy took a potato and carved out the insides. He blew the potato. That's right, man. He just fooled around with him and learned how to play it. So what I'm trying to get at was... I've always come in and warm up on Red's bass and fool around, and they were listening to the record. I couldn't hear the record too clear, so I ignored it. And Johnny come on, hey man, hey, play that thing again, that Blanton thing. I said, what Blanton thing, man? I got very drunk.
Yeah.
He said, that thing, you know, you playing the Blanton thing. We almost had a fight. I said, man, I never heard him yet. I said, I heard he can blow, you know, because Lady Wilcar, a piano player girl, had told me how great he was. And in those days, we weren't jealous of great bass players, man. We, you know, like,
of course.
Today you got another thing going with cats, like, they hate you if you think you can play. And I don't feel envy because Oscar Pettiford wasn't like that with me, man. We had complete love, man.
I know.
So finally, Red explained to him that I was a student and just learning to play, and I probably didn't know what I was doing. And so he said, well, just fool around and do what you're doing. I said, well, I do it different every time. Well, see? He said, well, do it different every time, but the next time when I tell you stop, keep holding that thing, you know? And so I said, Bebo, Bebo, do Bebo, the thing on Jack the Bear, this thing.
Yes.
Well, it does, on those days, that was bad on bass. No bass players were playing across the instrument, and I didn't know what I was doing, true enough.
Yes.
And so they got it and said, well, man, how you learn that? I said, well, I'm just playing what I felt, you know? I know that everybody knows, and you know, that you can recognize an angry sound in a person's voice or a frightened sound. Or a person is a contented sound, or a nervous sound, like my voice usually is at certain times.
Yes.
Not usually, I should say, at certain times.
Yes.
And these are the first things that a musician should look for. I'm trying to say this because I think I do have something special in music, and I'm ashamed, not ashamed, but a little shy to talk, to mention. But it goes back to the question you answered about hypnosis and all that. I'm afraid there is something like that. I don't know what it is because, first of all, Joe Glazer, it's so funny to tell you all this kind of story, said that two of his agents didn't like me. Mm-hmm. Says he's been trying to tell them to book me, this is years ago, to come by and hear his band. And so finally, the fella said, I'm sorry, I just don't like Charlie Mingus. When he's in a room, I feel miserable. Yeah, see, and only one guy said this. The other one never even commented why. And I began to notice myself that in certain moods, I walk into certain rooms and certain things happen. I've never done it to you, but I don't know if anybody can do it. And I watch certain people come in a room, like Bird at a certain time, could make the whole room feel the way he felt.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how.
Mm-hmm.
So before he even gets his horn in his hand, I've seen Bud and Bird, quiet Bird land down to a certain point where you could tell the audience, it's kind of a miserable agony going on in these two people. And yet Bird could contain himself. So I started experimenting to see what I could do. Now it's very easy, I found, to do it in the room. The people see me and let the thoughts run through my mind. And I have even sat in places and got people, the audience to come completely quiet. Now, at the show place, I experimented and didn't even come into the room and meditate and say, I'm coming out in a few minutes. The band's not even the bandstand. I'd like you people to quiet down and have you think, maybe I'm nuts, you know?
Yes.
But I've seen at times when, on a Saturday night, I could do this and feel myself go out of my body almost into the room with the people. And like they say, he's coming on, you know? And
mm-hmm.
then I come out, you could just, the sudden quietness in the room, you know? Yeah, I don't know how it is, but it sure is.
Yes.
And I'm trying to say now that in music, I could play a sad thing, you'd recognize it, because you're used to that. And I could play an angry, I could play happy little ditties like I do for my baby, you know?
Yes.
There's all kinds of emotions to play in music, but the one I'm trying to play is very difficult now because I'm trying to play the truth of what I am. And the reason why it's difficult, it's not difficult to play the mechanics of it, is because I'm changing all the time. I'm going through, I leave my analyst, you know, and I come back to him. I think he's completely off, and I think he's completely right.
Mm-hmm.
And remember I told you that this double woman, and all of a sudden I'm saying, Lord, I know I'm wrong. Man, this is the most sincerest album I've done in my life. In fact, I had a feeling I was going to die, man. Not because I did this album for you. I had a feeling that if I don't pull out of what I'm into, I want to tell you this, man, because maybe I might, you know, that I've been going through a psychological thing or spiritual, I don't know which, man. It's trying to reach the contempt and contain myself that I know that you seem to have. I know they can pull you off. Not like when your brother, when you talk to your brother, you get out for a second, but you got this certain thing that you always can call yourself back and say, let me contain myself.
Yes.
Automatically. Yes. Well, no one ever told me that. I never had any...
Yes.
And it's good I talked to you about this. I never had any idea or father image that sit around and was cool about anything. Anything that's something wrong, he knocked it down, you know?
Yeah.
This, and without, I never felt any love in my family. I finally remember the day I even gave it up.
Really?
I tried to get my father, my mother tried, she was a stepmother, but she tried, and when I found, he announced that she was our stepmother and things, I found out that that man, even today in my life, not that I hate him, it's just, I had nowhere to say, well, what am I supposed to be like? He never even told me that the world was like it was. He never said about black or white. He never told me anything, man. He never even tried to ball my fists up. And and people thought I was a coward because one day a kid wanted to fight me. And I said, all right, come on. I saw people fight. So I did like that, man.
Yes.
And I looked at this cat's man hand and it looked like a big club. And I looked down his fist. I said, ah, and ran, you know.
Yes.
Well, and no one really knew what was going on. I wasn't a born coward. I just knew that this is inadequate with this cat has got.
That's right.
And let me get out of here so I can figure out what he's doing.
That's right.
I mean, that, you know.
You weren't prepared.
No, man. And so, I don't care. You can write about this. This is what my music is. I felt just like I feel now when I went to Bellevue one time. Well, I'm not going because I know that's not where to go. And it took 3-4 hours that man let me in there begging him. Say, well, maybe I'm going to go crazy, but right now I feel like I need some help and you can give it to me. Some answers I need answered.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I kept having this reoccurring dream that I was in behind bars, in like a prison, and I helpless. I get to climb up, grab these bars, and I wasn't no strength. I'd fall back down. Well, when my analysis I was going to, after he got me out, began to talk, I discovered this was not in bars. This was a baby's crib. You dig it? I mean, this
course,
is very, very frightening thing, man. I'm trying to tell you what this music is about, man. Because if I had something about my childhood, it would all be down there. Because I was conscious and aware of my mother's death, my real mother's death, in bed, of sucking her breast and having it turn something wrong.
Yes.
And in other words, wherever it was, there was they took me and put me in a bed, and I was crying to get back to her, hungry, and she was dead, man. This I do know. My aunt has verified that. They don't even know how I know all this. This is why I went to Bellevue. I haven't told anybody this because I was trying to figure out what the hell kind of dream is this. I'm sucking this woman's bosom, you know, and because your mind don't know if you're big or little. It just remembers the bosom, and you start spitting and things, you know.
Yes.
And then the next thing I know, someone picked me up, and man, it's not really a dream. This is something a vision like, man.
Yes.
And then I saw them carry my mother out. That's when I got scared. I said, man, I know I don't know this. And I went to Bellevue and asked for help. And my analyst thought very little of it. He says, well, I didn't tell him what it was. He says, well, your mother died. I know you told me that. Tell me about her death. And as soon as he said that, I said, man, this can't be. He says, well, were there any bottles involved? You just sucked bottles? No, I'm a bosom baby. So I called my aunt and find out, you know.
It's amazing. It's amazing that you could remember.
Well, man, it's awful weird because, see, now my stepmother, my father made her jealous because she got and he put flowers in her grave all the time. And he accused, got mad at her because she took a picture of her down. And so she began to bug me with a thing about, I know she called me, man. See, I got ears. She said, Charles, that old-time voice.
Yes.
Charles. So I come running home from the kids playing. I said, Mommy, you called me? My stepmother. No, I didn't call you. See, my mother looked just like a witch. Oh, my stepmother, just like a witch. And she today, man, just like the kind of witch, if she had the hat and the broomstick, she'd be bad. You know, I'm serious. I'm not putting her down. She knows it, man. In fact, I told her I went to see her in California. She said, huh? She said, that to me in the hair. I said, yeah, she's bad, man. So I said, Mama, you call me. Come on. She said, no, son. Only thing I can think that must be your dead mother calling you and telling you to be a good boy and look out. Now, a little baby being raised like this, all they told me about God and Jesus, man, and I made it. If it wasn't there, I made it, man. I believe so hard that one day I went to sit down as a man and relax for a minute, and I was meditating, I studied a little yoga, and I went to get up, and my body stayed there, man. I stood back and looked at myself in a chair, man. I've been scared kind of ever since.
Yes.
Because I couldn't, when I did come back, I couldn't move my hands and things to wake up. And that's part of this kind of piece, because I don't know how the recording, when I played it, I got to stand where I listened a million times. No, I think it came out the way we played in the room. As close as a record can get it. Enthusiastic. That was a very sacred piece, man. I was from, you know, real church. And no kind of church. It's the thing I'm going through is written in that piece there. Which, as I told you, I thought, if I don't pull out this time, I would die. You know, to talk like this sounds neurotic to a lot of people. My analyst is something you say. But he tried to explain to me why. But they made me believe in Jesus and God, not only Jesus Christ. I learned all of them.
Yes.
Muhammad, all of them. Yes. To me, all witnesses of God. That the earth to me looks so unfair, not to race alone, just unfair to love.
Yes.
And don't do color anymore. It's above that.
That's right.
Man is his own effort, none effort to get along with himself. It's trying to destroy the earth. I would like to, for some reason, that's not even good to some people. Like, I would like to enjoy kind of outdoor living and things, you know? All I want, man, is to write music and like to be able to plant corn. You know, I'm going to have a farmer, you know? I mean, this is all I like to do, is plant my own food and go swimming or what I want to do and go to play gym. But I'm confined like in a prison to have to do things a certain way. And I'm not, some people are not, I'm not alone. I can't be alone. I know there must be other people. And no communists, no isms. People that just like to say, well, I think I'd like to go over here for a while and leave my job. I'll see you later. I didn't feel like working today. A man should not have to do this. And I know that you're forcing the system, Nance, but I don't think that you...
We all have to face that. I mean, in our own ways and in our own occupations or in our own thought.
But why,
we all have to face that, right?
Yes, Nance, but man, we all lie, though. And Charle Mingus is the only wife I know, woman or person on this earth that has ever lied. She go to the boss. She didn't say she's sick. She said, well, I know I'm doing my job and you can't get a girl to do this much work. I can take it home and do it and bring it back to you. She said, I just don't feel like working there. I'm not coming in. You can fire me if you want to. And for some reason, she got away with that. Most people say, oh, I'm sick. You know?
Yes, yes, yes.
And there is a day when you don't want to go to work, man, but you got to lie about it.
Yes.
Not you.
I know what you mean.
Yeah. The idea that has governed life to make us think that we have to live another way than some other man way before we were born, said.
Very few of us are free.
I know, man, I know.
Very few of us are free.
That's the word is, invisible slaves.
And we're slaves, either really slaves.
We're really slaves in the system,
man. Or we create our own slavery. You understand? Our own illusion.
This could be mine. This, I hope it's not.
You create your own slavery.
Nez, this could be it, though. But, man, I know you could make all the money you want and still be the kind of slave I'm talking about.
That's
to the system.
Of course.
Because,
there's absolutely nothing to do. You still create obstacles for yourself.
Does it mean it's really not the way you think it is?
That's right.
That's what I'm trying to get through. I'm going to get through or die. Because I'm not going to, next time, whenever I sit down, this is not what's going on, but this is one time it did, trying to resolve my philosophy. I got I was so loose, I got my body and got scared because I couldn't hardly move myself again. Well, this time, I'm just going to, I'm just going with faith and see what kind of man I am, because I'm not the picture that I've drawn to some people. I'm not cruel, man. I love my little baby,
that.
Man, so much, man. I'm trying to give it, man. You know, I'm gonna get a whip her, man.
You know, I know.
Yeah, I know we got that. I know that, man.
Long time ago.
Yeah, man.
Now listen, tell me a little something.
I'm sorry to get on that, but you may have something there. You may.
Tell me a little something now about the tunes in this album.
Yeah, well, I was trying. That was based on Enthusiastic, what I just told you.
Yeah.
My struggle with myself to free myself from my imprisoned, my invisible prison chains, and also the ones that I have the reality. The real ones that I know are there, and I don't have to lie to myself. Like an analyst told Max Roach, that he has a right to protest, not the way he does, but things are unfair to the black man. Well, this is true, but you got to look at the other black men that go through strong, yes, and don't go around hitting at iron walls. And this is what my problem has been too. But the main thing, I feel people are chained me to a wall because they heard I'm a certain way. If I can get rid of that image, you help me do that, then I can make my living, because I don't fight club owners. I don't tear pianos. Yes. They tore my bass up. You remember, you read that at 9B? Charlie Mingus broke the strings off the piano? They didn't tell you the man destroyed my Italian instrument.
Yeah.
See, because Mingus did it, it's got to be right.
Yes.
They don't tell you about my bass, man.
Yes.
The movers knocked over me, pounds to fix it. Well, that's one little thing. Now, I tell you about Devil Woman, that, and then it completes from here to here, from the Devil to Ecclesiastics, contradiction. One cat is saying, I want that woman, get out and get me some dough. And saying, Angel Woman got to go and all that. Well, then they turn around and say, I know I've been wrong. Well, when I tell you about trying to, yes, send this girl out the streets and I couldn't make it, I'm not, yes, really a, yes, I'm not a pimp. Yes. Yet, man, there's a lot of money in it. But I can't, it's not being a coward, Nance. I know what this is wrong. I do know what God means. It ain't no jive, man. They can sell it any way they want in churches for profit, or so the ministers won't have to go out and teach in the streets no more. They can keep it and commercialize it so they want the truth is kind of lost like they're doing. But this kind of church that is in a man that lets him know that there is a right, a single right and a single wrong, that is includes me and you. Uh-huh. Like, we don't step on each other's feet without saying, excuse me. And if we do it intensely, something's wrong with us, and we got to spot all this and get it out of us.
Right.
Now, that is the truth that I'm concerned with, and as far as God is concerned. I don't want to shake his hand.
Yes.
I mean, I don't want to say, hey, man, I don't want the Immaculate Conception is unimportant if it's happening or not. It's what did the cat do after he got here. And however he got here, he was a little baby, and he grew up and learned certain things, and did he speak the truth? Not did he do any magic tricks.
Yeah.
This is what I know I got to get straight in myself. Well, this title, Oh Lord, Don't Let the Doctor Atomic Bomb Me, is my selfish me. I didn't realize what the hell I'd said to my wife. I said, like, drop it all over the world, but don't drop it on me, man. and now I know that it's also, them I would have said white. Well, not white man or whitey. What I mean is the power, the invisible power or source that seems to have kept the world in the history of the world, and certain kinds of people's power to where we are still pawns. You're a bigger pawn than I am, a knight maybe. I mean, I'm the people in heaven here to the thrones.
Yes.
Some people I met whose parents, they can chase all the way back to England, the kings and queens.
Yes.
And how did that cat look back there and figure in his system so his daughter would inherit $1 million today, I mean each year, $28.9 million, and not even be taxed on it, and then have other little corporations she'll set up and cheat me if she could and feel good about it. That's Oh Lord, don't let the doctor talk about me. And I think it's funny because I think the cat is saying they're going to destroy the world. I'm not for the atomic bomb, but I'm kind of for give me liberty, give me death. For one man to think that a man that didn't make all this, hanging out in space, it's what, the universe it's hanging in space. Could be seven more of these universes with Earth and suns and solar systems.
Yes.
What makes this man, you guys are more, think he can blow it up? And he didn't make it, man. Can you imagine a cat destroying what's that, Empire State Building? And he didn't build it? You take a cat, the average cat, would tell him, you got a job, destroy that building down there. Go destroy it and see what happened to him. That's why I am on atomic bomb. When the cat think he made that and can destroy life. I mean, the inside of life that comes from you living and breathing and thinking and not ever knowing what caused it first and not supposed to know till you go back and have to do it all over again like you've been doing. And that's why you're so contained, too. You've done it millions of times, Nance. Bird, too. I know you've been here. I know, man. Certain people I feel they've been here. It's not they're not supposed to run and rush back to death because they know that's life.
Yes.
It's you help to educate this whole scene here. This is one of these things out in space I believe that's maybe way behind time. As far as here's my final thing on God. If God was singular, he was a lonely being. They said there's one God. Well, he's pretty lonely. And I think he split himself up, so to speak, and made lots of people with all kinds of various ideas to communicate. And so you had to sit and rub his body and say, oh man, you know, all by myself. And then by having you over here and even the gangsters, everybody thinking something wrong, that's him. And he got to figure it out himself. You dig it? Like this big invisible source is us. Yes. Now, the spirit of him is in a bit in every one of us. We can ignore it or we can be completely blind to it. We can be killers and murderers. But it's still there. There's the divine source of creation. Yeah, Hog Calling Blues. I have to be honest, I titled that mainly because of what I heard. This is a case where a man in the band was so strong, you mind me saying, you know, Roland Kirk, that he put his entire personality to my music and I went with him.
Yes.
It became rock and roll. I said, well, man, I'm going there too. Yeah, I did with him. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. It's something that Max Roach used to say every time that he'd get those things and not going to clubs and hollering, you heard about. Well, say in print, he said, Max feel an inability to express his inner emotions. He says, well, Mingus, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. This is the way it should be, you know? And I just copped the title and as a little thing to Max, you know? Eat That Chicken was, as I said, sure, I've heard Fats, but I never heard Jerry Van Wonderen in person. Maybe I did in a union one time. He came by and gave a lecture, but I don't remember him playing. I was trying to capture only what I heard him do once, Fats. Mm-hmm. And because of Martin Williams, making me realize that if people go back in classical music and trace the old composers, that maybe before you can really be considered modern, you should be able to go back and do what those cats did.
Yeah.
And it's not too hard for me because I haven't really been that far removed anyway. I've been accused of being very far removed, but I don't think so. I don't think even on it is. I hear so much folk music that he's playing is ridiculous. I don't think
complete,
he's modern.
Man.
I wish that these people would stop getting rid of that word. They call him weird and all. He's not weird. If they listen in here, he's not weird. He's playing music, man.
I know. And it's music full of roots.
It is, man.
It's very traditional.
Every day, man.
That's the way it sounds to me. It's very traditional.
Yeah, man, it is. And man, what they're confronted with is the man, whether he's got his own sound and tone. He ain't playing like Bird. They're so used to hearing everybody sound the same. Eat That Chicken, I say, originally why I used to announce it as being a piece of Fats Waller wrote. What I really was, the truth is, I like to think he wrote it.
Yes.
Because England, I've heard some symphonies he wrote. And I summed up all the things he did as a clown, as a protest after I heard about what a serious musician he was.
Yes.
And got a chance to do some of these things in England. And also had a degree from Juilliard, which I didn't know. And to be a classical composer and also an organist, and was not able to get fair employment, let's say, in the wider field of music, say the full scope of music, not just in clubs.
Yes.
So he decided to pull his hat and go and make as much as he could, and he made a million or so, I imagine. And I was thinking about, maybe I'd like to make a million too when I did it. No. And I think I told you about Passions of a Man. I think everybody that's creative is a ham. When you really get down to it, a person, not really is creative, he's an actor.
Yes.
The mood or something, unless I say you can make what, remember I said the thing I'm trying to make is the ultimate expression of the true thing that I see, and which I say I'm trying, or else I would say I meant it. I'm trying to make that now in this age I'm in now. But a man is trying to react something he thought before and recapture and call it creativity. He's a ham actor. And this is in school, I taught dramatics. And I've always wanted to do something like this because I can change my voice. Hello, Nesuhi. How are you? No, by Joe. But all the things.
Yes.
Like I was jealous when Philly Joe got his out.
Yeah.
We used to do that together. Johnny Holo's boy, you know, old chapter. You know, we talked, you know, to each other, the things like that. Except he did one on Dracula, which I never tried Dracula. But I had many voices, man. And I was, even this day, I made a mistake and put the earphone on both ears. and I couldn't hear what I was doing, but I liked it so much I got through, I decided to leave it that way, you know, rather than make another one.
But it's kind of very different from the rest of the album, isn't it? I mean, it's that piece is kind of apart.
Yes, if it hadn't been for you, everything I've done would have been like this. In fact, I'd have been I'd somewhere else right now, but you went back, if you check with Pithecanthus erectus, that was, I think that, I have to say Duke, because I read this on the back of my album, and he said, he is, years ago, in the 30s, I'm trying to play music to introduce people to the music that I like to play for them. And I've got to start somewhere, way back someplace.
Yes.
And John Lewis has said this,
yes.
Very simple, to get them to do this. None success is that I kept starting way up somewhere, close to it, but never what I really believe, like the roots, like Fats and people like this, which I really do and have been raised around. And if that didn't work, I'd go back farther. And finally, yes. This album seems to go all the way back there and come up to...
So it has the two extremes.
Yeah.
It goes from one end of it, right?
It sure does, man.
It goes from one extreme to the other.
And I've always wanted to use voice, too, man.
In a way, it's like the story of your life, kind of.
It is. You got it. It is.
It has the whole span.
Except someday I'm going to have me a big band to record with. But only when I merit it, man. See, you got to make enough bread to record. I don't want to cause you some bread that they wouldn't pay for. But
I'm sure that they
I've been wanting to do a big band date for you, man. Because no big bands are playing. No big band, excuse me, man. Bass is playing the same. Now, even he must have thought of something else. But the conventions keep him there. Ray Charles changes. Even he changes since I've heard him before.
Yes.
He changes now. I'm not changing because you haven't got him anymore. But I've heard a change in his voice.
Yeah.
Now, Duke admits he stopped because they couldn't seem to accomplish what he's trying to say. But when Dizzy got his band, Dizzy spoke to me and said he wanted me to write some things. And his band broke up. Not this last one, the first big band. It's something he started doing there. If you remember, what was that called? No, it's all tempo. It's what John Lewis and what's it called Third Stream?
Yes.
Diz did one. Right now with his big band.
Are you talking about the one with Johnny Richards?
No, some young kid did this. Some new cat.
Oh, Lalo Schifrin.
Yes. Where's he from?
Argentina.
Yeah, well, I heard this man...
Educated in France.
Yeah.
In Argentina.
Yeah, I thought he was a French composer. Conservatory. I thought he was a French composer. Wait,
yeah.
I heard.
Well, he's...
Well...
His education is French.
Nah, I was like, well, I got ain't nothing like that. But yet, I used to write like that. When I heard this cat, I said, man, you know George Handy?
Yes.
Man, we used to do things and meet and say... Man, how the heck you gonna write this? And I met you, and it's so similar. He used to be a good booster of mine. Johnny Roberts even tried to help me on that in California. When I wrote, tried to write for big band.
Who did?
Johnny Richards. Yes. Was it only band? Sonny Burke was gonna do some, and the band broke up. Remember that band?
Yeah.
He had several of my pieces.
Yeah.
I still have them around, but that's not it either. It's what something to give you an idea. It's blues and roots. Gave me the idea. This is big band music, man. Like the one horn, oh, but oh, did, oh, did, ba, ba, da, ba, da, da, da. Now, that's a reed section.
Yes.
You dig it? Now, like they're playing parts. It don't have to be a riff, but see, that's the start. And then another horn again. Now, dig it. It start there, Snares, but the whole thing I do, the reed section, to give you a picture. It's like a solo, but one that's constructed so it's not too much going on. But a bo ba do dee bo do go ba da ba do do down ba do do reed section. Everybody's blowing. You follow that reed section? When they finish their line, they keep it going. It becomes a background for the next line. The same as we did in that. Man, I know it's gonna upset the people, man. Dizzy called me. He just heard Blues and Roots. You know. You won't believe it, man. This cat almost crazy on the phone. Man, you motherfucker. You saw man. What is this shit? He said, I didn't know you were doing all this. He just last week, man.
No kidding.
He's flipping on that record, man. He said he had it in the house there on his shelf. And he had a rehearsal. He said, I'm going to play Omegas. Let's have some laughs, like weird shit. And he said, man, why they call you weird? He said, that's church, ain't it? He said he put the record on. He said he liked to flip, man.
No.
And that, I'm saying, one of the things I want to do with a big band, man, not the big band ain't dead. See, if you keep doing what they're doing, you're going to think it's dead because you hear the brass. Choo-cha-do-da! do 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 reach do 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 do. Plunk, plunk. You think it's dead, man.
There's this whole. For 25 years.
There's this something out there for you, man. There's something just like you change your suits. Sure. You don't wear the same suit you wore 50 years ago. It's sad for you, man.
But it hasn't happened in big bands. Nobody has done it.
No, man. I know they haven't, man. I think I'm gonna do it.
Right. In 20 years, there has been no really important.
No, it hasn't, man. That's why Duke and those guys are supposed to sit there.
Yeah.
But the thing about it, maybe they're responsible. I don't know. And this, I'm no judge anymore. Just sit back. There's something to be done, man. I'm pretty sure that remember this, some of these things, things to come, was a direction. But see, a young man, all the guys sitting there, and everything is running good. You know, too much.
Too much.
Take some of it out, you know?
That's right.
Let it digest, man.
That's right. Now, some people will think, maybe I'm wrong, but let me just ask you this question. Some people will think that in some of these pieces, you're putting the music down.
Putting someone on. No.
But you're not doing that,
no,
right?
No, man.
I think we should make it very clear.
If I'm putting it down, I'm putting myself down. How could I put down Fats Waller? How could I put down the kind of thing I was singing on Devil Woman or Ecclesiastics when this is everything that's in my life? Fats is in my life, and jazz or whatever music you want to call it. Or I wouldn't be playing. It's a music that he was responsible for that creates my living. And Ecclesiastics is a bastardization of the word Ecclesiastics. And I used to announce it, it's still my identity is trying to be accepted by my own people as a black man. The whole struggle, the whole truth in this record of what I think good of myself and bad of myself is in this one record here. So if it's insincere, then I'm not alive, because you can't live and be insincere. I mean, I'm trying to hang on to everything that I know is true, and I'm looking down at your titles right now. Oh, Lord, don't even drop the atomic bomb on me. And I know it's a selfish title, because some other people don't want to drop nowhere near them. Now, Hard Calling Blues was after I wrote a tune and given the lines out, Roland Kirk took over and played his way, and by me staying and playing what I'd written in the forums and not going to him, I would have destroyed the piece. So I saw what he had, and it came out like a farmyard smells. You know what I'm talking about? If you get near it, you're going to know some pigs around there. And I said, my friend, Wham, it sure is funny how you got it. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. You got quotations and question marks and things, you know, because that's the way I would feel. That if you write what Max would feel at a certain time when he'd say this thing as a question, and what is the answer to my life, Mingus? Where do I go? What is it all about? So it's like, it shouldn't be like that, Mingus. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. It's supposed to be clean and cut dry so I know what the answer is. And Passions of a Man is still tying up as me trying to be identify myself with something. I've often felt no flag, no country, no love or nothing. And maybe, as you say, it's me living in a world that I made for myself. I don't know this yet. You could be right. You haven't said this about me, but you said it could be this, that people do this. Maybe I've done this to myself. But I doubt that all of it is like this. There's some reality in the fact that they are killing each other. I mean, races are killing each other because, not really because they're a certain race, really. It's a little cleaner now. You can tell what it is now. You can tell that it's the economic setup of a system. So here I made a record called Passions of a Man, and I would have said it was like the passions of a black man. But the black people that I've met in the past, which affected me most is my childhood, made me feel that I wasn't good enough to be black. I wasn't like, who am I? Like, you know, my hair wasn't beautiful, nappy like there was. My skin wasn't dark, ebony, black, and beautiful like they were. They made me feel ugly. They called me shit-colored motherfucker. You little black, you know, half-yellow, shit-colored motherfucker. That's what they called me all through school until I learned to segregate and go away from segregate myself from them. And I go to the white man, he wouldn't accept me. So I end up by myself and find maybe a Japanese kid who would say hello, and we finally get a couple of words in the next hour and it said, how you doing? And he finally tell me he was kind of lonely because nobody talked to him. And we got a little kind of another thing going. And a couple of color cats came in, like Buddy Collette. He was black as tar, but he came in with us because he didn't dig the black cats or the yellow cats that congregated and segregated and made hate up. Buddy joined, and he was black, and I was shit color, as they said, and Noble Oki was slant-eyed. And there was a Jewish fellow there named Levy. I don't remember his first name now, but I remember it was Levy. And there was a Greek fellow who was his father on the store. These kind of people got together and started talking about things that I don't think people are talking about yet. And I'm just still trying to tell you that if this record ain't sincere, then I'm not sincere. I'm not here. So you're not hearing nothing. I'm not really saying nothing else. I wouldn't know which they would think I was putting down, Eat That Chicken. It's a happy piece of music. I was just going to come into that next,
you know. Now, in this session, unless I'm mistaken, this session was not really carefully planned as some of your other albums were planned. I mean, you came and...
Well, we played.
Right? I mean, you played and you sang things as they occurred to you.
It was very natural.
You hadn't rehearsed those lyrics and so on.
No, I had no idea.
It was really, you were improvising the words along with everything.
Yeah, I really want to sing. I want to sing, because I like my singing voice.
Now, there's a lot of emotion,
mm-hmm.
right? You mean everything, it's full of, but at the same time, there's a lot of humor.
It should be, man. When that goes out of life, we all go, I guess.
Right.
If you can, man, I've been the sickest, and if you can laugh, it kind of smolders away.
And there is humor, but because there is humor, it doesn't mean you're putting it down at all.
Well, I think if they listen, they'll see that because it's pure humor. And then when this here goes to what it goes to, which is the key note, and there's a little story going on that I'm sure you heard.
Yes.
It mentions a little hate that says America.
Yes.
And it says nigger. And it says nigger pretty not clear with an accent, nigger.
Yes.
And he says, yeah. I'm getting a thought that says, where? In America. They call it nigger, nigger. And he goes, yeah. And then there's a little threat to that, as you said, mau mau. Well, a person can get the whole story. That I heard a program that was Spanish, the advertiser says, really experiment. And it's very good. Sweet. You know, I said, well, this, you can tell a story like that. You know,
yes.
I didn't understand what they were saying, but they were selling really experiment and it was sweet and it was good gum.
Yes. Yes.
So that's why I say, well, I can get a point over like this, and I think I did. Because the whole thing ends with saying freedom over the world. That's the whole thing that would give people any kind of peace is freedom. And to say that I ain't got no chains on me don't mean I'm not a slave.
That's right.
You know?
That's right.
And as you say, I still can't believe what you said, that I might put those chains in myself. The extra ones. But there's something there.
Yeah.
But this is not it. You know, man's not responsible for this. You know, it's how do I know all this? I got the God's answer. I think I have. When I said that God has been split himself up in all these ideas to make it last, to make it good for him to live, because he couldn't sit there and rub his hands together and say, well, what a nice day it was.
Yes.
So he's speaking with each other in our bodies. And I was like, man, I'm going to tie it together, I thought.
I think you have.
Yeah.
I think you have.
Yeah. How can you say you're not enjoying it? Or how can I judge and say it's ugly or bad or good when it's just for me like this and I'm only a part of this eternal life or this part-time life? Well, it's been going on quite a while now, so it certainly isn't part-time. I guess we did about everything we can do.
Yeah, I guess that's it.
Oh, some work for somebody.
Well, look, I'll show you something out of all this.
Okay. I felt that we should do it like this. I don't know.
I think it's a good idea.
Yeah. You said it so fast.
I'm going to... edit and show you probably more than what we can use, because you know, liner note, you know, can only be like
so much,
1,000 words, you know, 1,200 words or something. I'll just take the essence of it, you know, like
a lot of things I said twice on there.
Just the body of it,
yeah.
And I'll show you probably even more than we need, and then you can just cross off,
yes,
and just leave there what you think is the essential thing,
yes.
And I probably won't even do it like a dialogue, but just things you say. I'm not going to worry about making it a complete story with the beginning and end.
Yeah.
Statements from Mingus. You know what I mean? Yes. It doesn't have to be related like one article.
Yes.
You know, like one paragraph. That's good. One
on each one of these tunes.
Or tunes or ideas you have. Not just on the tunes.
Yeah.
You know, like you talk about, say, I don't know, Blanton. Separate. Yeah. Something about this tune, separate.
Yeah, that'd be good.
And you know, and then I'll mention your book.
Okay.
If you're interested in that.
Yeah, the book. Because this is the book.
Logical thing.
This is the musical part of the book.
This is the musical
part. It sure is, man. It's right there.
Charlie, thank you very much.
Thank you, man.
It's going to be great.
Thank you for letting me do it this way. I wanted to be surprised.
Man, I love you. You know that.
I know that. And there's, you know the feeling I had when I told you I like doing it on tape? I felt that you thought about it, too. I said, man, the way you said yes, we'll do it.